Yeah.
Unique New York.
Have you ever wished Kurt Angle to wish your significant other a happy birthday? Have you ever wanted Jake the Snake Roberts to wish you condolences on the passing of a loved one?
Have you ever wanted anyone in your life to be wished a solemn and dignified Ramadan by the Honky Tonk Man?
Well, head on over to FAAM.us. That's FAAM.us. And you can get all these things and more. Get Kurt Angle to tweet you happy birthday if you're lonely enough. But when you do, make sure to use our code FUDPODCAST, F-U-D podcast, and give us a little kickback. Again, last FM. What the fuck? FAAM.us, FUD Podcast. Now, our feature presentation. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the fourth episode of Mucha Lucha. This is Tyler Fudge here, and you're listening to the Funeration Podcast. Essentially, this is Mucha Lucha. This is all Lucha Underground. And today, I have a special guest. Usually, I do these long, drawn-out intros because the guest is somebody you haven't seen for a while or you don't know, so I try to tell you who they are. I'm not going to try to tell you who they are because if I do, this guy's ego is just going to go through the roof. And basically, the whole gist of this episode is since I got a tweet on the internet, yes, on the internet, from this guy asking me, don't you go boo me, you son of a bitch, from a guy asking me what Tell thought of Fastlane. And, well, I didn't keep your fucking hand down. I ain't done. But I'm all off on my train of thought here. I didn't want to review Fastlane for a second time, so I had to let that guy down and say, sorry, Tell wasn't available for Fastlane. Instead, I figured, you know what? I'll get him in on Mucha Lucha. He's not a fan of Lucha Underground, and not saying he's not a fan, he's just not all caught up on it. And like I tell you in the intros of these cocksucking episodes, that this is just to embrace Lucha Underground. I'll have episodes with fans, diehard fans, people that have no idea what Lucha Underground is, people who are new to it. That's the bliss that is Mucho Lucha. Now, Tell has been clamoring to speak because it kills him if he's not heard. So, Tell, say hi to everybody.
Hola.
Hola. That's all you had?
First thing, Mr. Tell, this is a show all about Lucha Libre wrestling. Shouldn't I be Senior Tell?
Senior Tell? Yep.
See?
Yeah. You know what? Sure. Okay. You can be Senior Tell for a day.
I can dig it.
Because I know how much you hate Mr. Tell.
Man, Miss Dude will be Dr. Tell.
But see, you're already known now. See, people are asking for you as Mr. Tell.
So. And you know what? Those people are losers.
I didn't say that. He did. I just called you guys cocksuckers.
Getting that heel heat.
So Tell, what experiences do you have with Lucha Underground? Tell them what you've seen so far.
Okay, so I saw the February 26, 2016 episode of Lucha Underground. And then before that, I watched like a season and a half worth of Jackie Chan Adventures with El Toro.
Okay.
He was a Lucha Libre wrestler with like the bull talisman, and he was kicking ass all day.
Did you ever watch the show in which I ripped off my theme from?
No.
Mucha Lucha?
No.
No? Mucha. No, there's a TV show.
I thought that was like the Lucha Dragons.
No, it's like Mucha Lucha, Mucha Lucha. It's a way of life. Mucha Lucha. No,
but nope.
Where my show is called Mucha Lucha, I figure fuck it. Fuck copyrights. Anyways, back to your story. Sorry to cut you off.
That was it. I mean, this is my first time checking it out.
Yeah, you've seen the Vampiro Pentagon match from Ultimate.
Yeah. I watched that. And then I heard that Johnny Mundo.
John Morrison.
He's in this now. I like that his last name is Mundo.
Yeah, it makes him Mexico.
Yeah. Mundo is the name of a dude from League of Legends. I play that real hardcore.
There you go.
Dr. Mundo knows where you live.
Is that you or is that me?
That's me.
You should put that on silence, sir.
That's done, my bad.
Respect. I know you hate the fans because you're a heel and all.
Well, you know what? You can't even say that statement, Tyler. It's not just the fans. It's what? Everybody.
Okay, fine.
Yeah. Whatever. I hate fans. I hate the internet. I hate... So, we did this last time. Yeah.
Yeah, we went through this last time. Tal doesn't like people. He doesn't like you. He doesn't like me. I don't know why I have him on. But we waste no time this episode. In the show, we see Vampiro, and he is off his meds. Says that last season he found the man that would allow Ian to free Vampiro from his mind. That man was Pentagon Jr. Vampiro says to not let anything get in our way, not even her. The girl in the picture, this is not going to mean a roll of beans to you, but the girl in the picture looks like Katrina to me. And Katrina is, you know, the girl with the powers in this TV show. I've heard her called, what did I say she was?
Necromancer?
Yeah. I've heard her described as a necromancer, and maybe it's an old timey picture. Maybe it ties in somewhere.
Yeah.
You know. So maybe who knows?
Tyler said Katrina like four times. The only thing I could think about was Hurricane Katrina, and I know that Pentagon Jr. is dead, right?
No.
Oh, who's dead? One of the dudes is dead. That's his gimmick.
Oh, Mil Muertes.
Yeah. Okay. Never mind.
Yeah. That's her. That's her man. That's her cockle. So the first match of the night is Jack Evans versus PJ Black, the Darewolf. This is PJ Black's second match. His first match was a loss. And this match, another L on the column for the Darewolf.
0-2.
0-2. So, but it starts off, though, with some great mic work by Jack Evans. He says, "Quiet down, the hero you never knew you had is about to speak. And it's the man that the haymakers, the naysayers, the Dragon Slayer, Jack Evans." Of course, alluding to how he beat Drago a few weeks ago. I believe it was the third episode of Lucha Underground, if I'm not mistaken.
You're not mistaken. I believe you're
right. Oh, thank you, sir. Thank you.
Now, this guy was pretty cool. Jack Evans.
Yes.
I don't really... The other guy seemed pretty white bread.
I've came on record on this show saying I'm not a fan of Justin Gabriel. Yeah, Justin Gabriel.
Yeah.
And PJ Black.
The Darewolf?
Yeah, that name is pretty bad.
All I can think of is in the grade 6 curriculum in Canada, we have what's called the DARE program, the Dare to Resist Drugs and Alcohol, and it's got a picture of like a tiger.
Does it?
It's the mascot's like this tiger dude.
I always just remember the red letters.
Yeah.
On the t-shirts.
They didn't work very well for you, did it?
No. I never ever got what they were.
Yeah.
So we get a springboard spin kick by Evans, and here's Drago with big ass horns. This pisses off Evans, who throws a tantrum and a ball of water at Drago. From behind, PJ hits the Black Diamond, which is basically a shoulder mounted cutter, but only gets a 2.
Yeah.
Drago then comes ringside, sprays mist into the eyes of PJ Black by mistake. Evans hits a bridging backslide and gets a victory. I really don't know what else to call it. It's a bridging backslide. It's the same way he beat Drago.
It's the coolest pin I've seen in a long time.
It's really cool.
The thing I don't get about Drago is that Drago is a Mexican dude who's a half dragon or whatever. And I can suspend disbelief for that. But I'm just confused as why nobody thinks it's weird that he's got a pair of nunchucks. Like, he's not a Japanese dude.
Yeah, the nunchucks is the first time I've ever... I've never seen nunchucks.
Cholos just aren't, like, cruising around in their 6'4s with nunchucks hanging out.
Cruising down the street in my 6'4.
Like, where'd he get them? Why does he have nunchucks?
Fuck it. That's why. He's Drago. Where'd he get the big-ass horns?
Could he be, like, Ivan Drago? Could he just show up, like...
Ivan Drago is.
What?
No.
Tyler, Rocky IV kills Apollo Creed because Apollo Creed can suck it and Sylvester Stallone won't win an Oscar. Boom.
Have you
ever seen the Rocky movies?
No.
What?
Yeah.
There's a black guy dies in the 4th one.
I know who Apollo Creed is.
Okay. Ivan Drago kills him.
Okay,
fair. Without nunchucks.
Without nunchucks.
Or green mist.
Or green mist. Fair enough. So basically he's not the Jerry.
No.
So basically PJ Black now has not won a match since debuting at the Temple. Shame, shame, shame. But right after that, we go into probably the best vignette known to man, right after a Johnny Mundo workout video. We get a famous B commercial. You go from a Jabba to a Rabba. Just call 423 Get Fame now. Long distance charges may apply. Standard text message phrases may vary. Please ask your parents' permission before calling.
So is this Johnny or not? Who's this guy? This
Famous Me?
Famous Me. Is he
no
a
fucking idea.
Is he a wrestler? Is he a manager?
Yeah, he's a wrestler.
Okay, so he's not like Jay Lethal's dude.
No, he's as far as I know, he is a just a California, a SoCal California wrestler.
Yeah.
Where I believe Lucha has a lot of guys under contract down there.
Yeah.
So why not use him? Yeah, Famous B. I believe. Yeah, no, I because I had Rob LaFoon on last week.
What?
For Mucha Lucha.
Man.
And he's training at the San Patino Brothers.
Yeah.
And they got a lot of guys from the San Patino Brothers.
Yeah.
Right? So, like, Thunder Rosa, who is Cobra Moon, she started training a couple months after Rob did, kind of deal, right? So, and she's on Lucha Underground.
Yeah.
So, but.
So, I mean, a quick intro to Rob LaFoon. I actually went to high school with Rob LaFoon.
Rob talked about it.
And you know what?
Rob talked about it.
He can suck it.
He said along the same lines as you did.
Yeah.
He said that, he said something along the lines of that you guys had a wrestling match before.
Yeah.
And he said next time he's up, he's going to take you down again.
You know what, Rob LaFoon? I'll tell Rob LaFoon right now. Anytime you think you're big enough, I'm down, Rob.
See? There you go. There you go.
This is it.
I've started a fight.
The King of the North versus the Pretty Boy in the South.
I've started a fight. The what would you consider yourself, a boxer?
Yeah.
The boxer versus the pro wrestler. Not bad.
His style ain't strong.
He don't know a real punch.
Diet Nakamura.
So speaking of Diet Nakamura, let's go into King Cuerno versus Killshot. Nobody gets an entrance in this match here. They're both just there.
Yeah.
You miss King Cuerno's great entrance with the deer on his head. He has a big deer head on top of his head, and it's like a draping cape kind of deal.
Yeah.
It's pretty dope. It's got the antlers and shit. So basically, Cuerno isn't defending the title, the Gift of the Gods title, because he has a deal with Katrina where her and Mill are safe with him as a champion, adding to the fact that the announcers aren't aware to the backstage vignettes, because they bring up at the beginning of this match, that why isn't he defending this title? Mm-hmm. And it's a running thing in Lucha Underground that the announcers don't know what's going on backstage.
Oh,
so
okay.
All these vignettes you see, the announcers know nothing of it.
Yeah.
So they don't know that Cuerno has a deal with Mertes.
That's
so,
cool.
You know, that's pretty cool.
I dig it. I like that this seems to be a real nuanced level of storytelling in Lucha Underground. I feel like there's a story that's got to be told.
Yes.
Not like kind of other wrestling where it's just you see like these storylines kind of happen. I feel like this is really mapped out well.
Well, they've signed everybody to 7-year contracts.
Holy shit.
So it seems as if they've got a good outline of where they're going in those 7 years to get there. So,
I mean, Mark Burnett knows how to structure a reality show.
Oh, yeah.
Survivor's been on, what, 20 seasons?
It's not slowing down anytime soon. Yeah. He basically coined this whole reality movement.
Yeah.
But in this match, we get a beautiful attempted dive to the outside by Killshot, where Cuerno ducks out of the way, causing Killshot to catch himself, do a handspring off the apron and onto the floor. I've never seen that. It's very, very nice. But Cuerno answers by flying an arrow right to the heart of Killshot, which is when he goes.
He does the,
the arrow and he does
Katniss
the double. Yes, yes. It's I love it, honestly. But then that gets cut off as well, and Killshot goes for a cutter on the apron.
Oh, yeah.
And basically grabs him by the wrist and just brings him spine first onto the apron, and they both make a nasty fall to the outside. And Vampiro says, please don't try this at home.
Let's leave this to the professionals. And someone's like, yeah, that wasn't very pretty. And Vampiro's like, yeah, but that looked like it really
hurt. Yeah.
I don't think that was on script. I think that was just improv. That was all right.
Oh, yeah. No, it's good in ways. So Killshot reverses a tombstone into a front-facing codebreaker, skips the pin, goes right up top for a force for a fucking force through a score. A corkscrew 450. He misses the shot, though. Get it?
Yeah.
Cuerno hits the thrill of the hunt, gets the win. Post-match, he beats down Killshot because of the botched cutter.
Yeah.
And he goes for a twisting tombstone, but Phoenix comes out for the save. So, I don't think you know anything about Phoenix. Phoenix and Cuerno have fought a lot. They're like, they've had two matches so far this season. This will be the third.
Yeah.
And this is only the sixth episode.
They're like Randy Orton and that Irish dude.
But they're all great. Sheamus?
Yeah.
But they're all great. Their matches are amazing.
You mean Randy Orton and Sheamus are great matches?
Yeah, no.
I don't know, Tyler.
I don't know what you're watching, but... And you were asking during the show while we were watching it, it's like, what's the Gift of the Gods championship?
Yeah.
I figured, what better chance than now to explain to you what the Gift of the Gods
championship
is. Okay, so in season one, Dario Cueto, which comes in later in the episode, and you know who Dario Cueto is, he had these medallions. They were the, I can't remember what they were called. Maybe they're called the Gift of the Gods medallions or something. I can't remember anyways. Each medallion represented an ancient tribe, one of the seven ancient tribes.
Yeah.
And there's a series of matches to win these medallions. And then all the winners of the medallions had a match.
Oh, like a seven-man battle royale.
Yeah. Yeah. And the winner got the Gift of the Gods title where all the medallions fit in the belt.
That's pretty cool.
And that belt became their quasi Money in the Bank. So if you hold that belt, then you can fight the world champion anytime, any place.
Yeah.
So Phoenix won that at Lucha Underground. Ultima Lucha.
Yeah.
And then that's basically the end of the season one. He wins it, and he loses it on the first episode of season two to King Cuerno.
Yeah.
And now it's a rematch for the Gift of the Gods title.
Yeah.
Phoenix has had a history with Mil Muertes and Katrina. He was making out with Katrina for a while.
Oh.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, under that mask.
Oof.
In one of the first episodes, he sneaks into her office. Like, she's turned around looking at the window, and he opens the door. And it's like, as soon as he opens the door, she's like, I still get a tingling in my blood when you come near, or something like that, right? It's just like, when she still wants Phoenix's dink.
Yeah. Now, like, that's one of the things, too, from these vignettes. I can tell that Robert Rodriguez has something to do with this. Because Robert Rodriguez really has a typical kind of style for dialogue.
Yeah.
And this very much so feels like a Rodriguez production.
Well, he's getting as much out of wrestlers as he can.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? There are some notoriously bad acting in this series.
But I mean, there are some notoriously bad acting in Robert Rodriguez movies.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, from Dusk Till Dawn is no masterpiece.
Yeah.
If you ask me, well, it's not just his movies. Quentin Tarantino's movie too, but there's pieces in that could be better.
Could you imagine if Tarantino had anything to do with pro wrestling?
Oh man, oh man, they'd be scalping people and everything. They'd be the most racist thing in the world. Like, they give a tombstone, just blood would cover the mat. Yeah.
2 hours of nothing, and then just shit hits the fan.
Yeah. It's just the story of Drago, Pentagon, and Prince Puma driving to the show.
Yeah.
Then when you get to the show, it's all bloodbath. So this brings us to our gauntlet match, which is Tejano versus Chavo Guerrero and the crew, which is Cisco and Cortez Castro, the undercover FBI agent or cop that I was telling you about with Joey Ryan, who you don't see in this episode, Shane. But basically, I'm going to breeze through this match because I was not a fan of this match at all. Cisco started the match, super kick, and he's out. In comes Cortez Castro, pop-up powerbomb by Tejano to Castro, and he's eliminated. Tejano says, Viva Mexico, and Castro trips Tejano with a bull rope, and Chavo gets the win.
Yeah.
Tejano, a lot of people love Tejano. I'm not one of them. I think he's very generic. I think he's basically your Sheamus of Lucha Underground.
Yeah.
But Tejano has a decent history in Mexico.
Yeah.
He's the youngest ever Mega Champion.
Mega
Champion, which is their heavyweight champion.
Yeah.
He held that for 2 years until Alberto Del Rio beat him for it. And he's the youngest. So, yeah, and did I say he's the youngest ever?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. That's basically his whole claim to fame.
Yeah.
But in AAA, he's a big deal. I'm not a fan.
He seems okay. I want to say that he seems pretty like white bread.
Yes.
But he's Hispanic, so he's brown bread.
Whole wheat. Rye.
Yeah. Yeah, he seemed okay. Nothing great. Not as, you know, his gimmick wasn't really, I didn't feel like I needed to suspend disbelief for it, so I was kind of bored by him.
Yeah, I agree with you there. It's I wasn't a huge fan. I'm still not a huge fan of him in general. But from there, till we take a trip. 375 miles from Boyle Heights, Dario Cueto and Black Lotus, her real name is Angela Fong, and she's Canadian.
What?
Yeah, are outside the temporary home of Matanza, training him to return to the temple. So basically, the whole deal is Matanza is a demon or a god inside of this guy's body. And they want to bring him to the temple to unleash him onto the temple. Mm-hmm. So he can just kill people, I guess. And Matanza has been coming around since the first season. You've never seen him.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. So he's supposed to be this monstrosity of a dude. And they've hidden for a season and a third. You know what I mean? So it's pretty cool.
He's like Braun Strowman without the baby face.
I just hope he's a lot better of a wrestler than Braun Strowman. Jesus.
It's just Taz.
Jesus Christ. Dario says that his mother was El Diablo, and one day he had enough and told his mother to stop. She came at him with a hot iron, if it wasn't for his brother, killing his mother with a Red Bull statue. Not a statue of a can of Red Bull, but a Red Bull statue.
He gave her wings.
Yeah. Got his own wings. That was the day Dario learned that he loves violence. Katrina is walking then, and Pentagon yells at her, catcalls her. Tells her, bring them titties on into this ring. That's not what he says. He says that he wants Puma. Her Puma. She replies by saying that he can't have her Puma because of what he did to Emil's Puma. And that, why would I ever grant you anything you want? Pentagon strikes back and says, because I can touch your Puma. He actually says, because I can break your arm too. I'm basically just trying to get as much entertainment out of this as I can. But we get our first karate fight of the night, and you're not very up on your Lucha Underground karate knowledge, but every episode has a few karate fights.
What?
Yeah.
I can dig it.
And this is the first and only one tonight. Yeah. Usually you get more than one. Everybody that debuts at a karate type vignette.
Just some Hicks and Gracie beating up 400 people at one time.
PJ Black beat up these two luchadors on motorcycles.
Yeah. Just on some Ip Man shit.
Yeah, yeah. So just, and everybody seems to beat up the same guys. So Pentagon has Katrina into that cross arm breaker where he breaks everybody's arm. And he basically tells Katrina that you should listen to me because I can break your arm just like I broke Mills. The lights go out, Katrina's out of the hold, and she's in the corner. She says that he can have Prince, but it'll be the worst mistake he's ever made.
Yeah.
So next week, you've got a match between Prince Puma and Pentagon Jr., which should be an amazing match, barring there's no shenanigans. Yeah. If that makes any sense.
I feel like it's cool that this Katrina chick has superpowers. She reminds me of one of the Mystery Men. Like, she can teleport, but only in the dark.
She's got to turn the lights out first.
Yeah.
Yeah. Baby, when the lights go out.
Tyler, I think you sing every episode.
I sing a lot, actually. And it's usually some boy band shit that I'm very embarrassed about, like five.
Next week will be Mbop by Hanson.
Oh, man. Oh, man. Did I ever tell you a story about how I requested that at a Christmas party one time?
No.
I was the cat's fucking meow, bro.
Yeah, bro.
I I marched up to that stage, bro, and I said, give me fucking Mbop, man. Give me fucking Mbop.
No. Damn, Tyler on them white man tunes.
Fuck, I feel like a pedophile when I fucking love Hanson.
Like oh, that. Jesus, it's the children of the corn.
That's Family Guy, isn't it? So our main event tonight is Johnny Mundo versus Cage.
That dude is big.
He's huge.
He's like American Colossus.
He is America personified. It's essentially what he is. With the facial hair, the mohawk, and the roids, and the needle marks on his ass.
Which Tyler spent like all the time we watched this episode.
I'm just trying to find where the needles go in.
His needle could go in.
Whoa.
One thing I noticed too is that this show's not PG.
No,
that caught me off guard.
Not even a little bit. Yeah, no, we were 15 minutes in here, like, this ain't PG. Nope, it's not. this match here, you know, it had some good spots. It had some flubs, as you will. To me, myself, I don't see Cage as being the greatest wrestler in the world. He's pretty good for a big guy, but he does mess up a couple things every now and then. It's forgiven, I suppose.
He seems creative.
Yes, yeah. Very, very. He has a lot of creative moves in his arsenal that I can't really tell you what they are.
Yeah.
You know, it's a lot of spinnings and catching and hooks and down.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And it's just like way too much for me to get a grasp of. I'll never know the difference between your moves.
Yeah.
But boy, oh boy, do I like you calling an F5 Bluetooth destroyer.
That is pretty cool.
I really do like that a lot.
I mean, I think one of the things that really separates like lazy big guys from cool big guys is just maybe even the names of the moves, but how the moves are applied. Like if you look at any move that Ryback has ever done,
well, so it looks flimsy. Like
any move anybody's ever done before.
Yeah.
And it's just there's no innovation to it, right? There's no creativity.
Well, like now, I gotta give kudos to Ryback, okay?
Okay.
Because as soon as CM Punk quit, okay, so like you talk about how he has no innovation, right? So as soon as CM Punk quit, he sends out a tweet. I call dibs on the GTS, right? And then Wade Barrett gave his notice.
Yeah.
And Ryback,
what?
Yeah.
Wade Barrett's quitting?
Yeah.
Oh man.
Ryback sent out a tweet. I call dibs on the bull hammer, right? So just take it out and
buddy's. Doesn't mouth. He already have the meat hook?
Yeah.
Is it the same thing?
No, it's the discus elbow is what the bull hammer is. Meat hook is just a fucking clothesline lariat. But yeah, so Johnny Mundo and Cage, they both head up top. Mundo slides down the post like the weasel he is. He kicks Cage in the head and then kicks the feet out. Cage falls down to the, and rolls to the outside. But then Johnny Mundo does a step-up springboard corkscrew that looks pretty fucking sweet.
That was cool.
Yeah.
I believe in his parkour. I made a hardcore parkour
I'm pretty
joke.
Sure he actually does. And yeah. Which I know Tyler, so bad hardcore parkour.
Tyler didn't get the Office reference at all.
No.
No.
I did start watching a TV show called Superstore.
Is that about The Office?
No.
It's about an office?
It's about like
the Superstore?
A bunch of people that work at a Superstore.
And? Isn't he good?
It's pretty good, I must say. That chick, Ugly Betty's in it. American Vieira, I guess.
I don't know.
She's in World of the Traveling Panthers, Sisterhood of Traveling.
I don't know why you're talking to me Pantolins. Like, yeah, you watch that, right, Tel?
Fuck off, man. I like some shows like that. So after we get this little corkscrew looped in a loop, you get a nice line by Stryker, which is, the warranty may be running out on this machine.
That was
you
pretty clever.
Coy son of a bitch, Matt Stryker. You coy son of a bitch.
That seems like it's improv too, man. Like that's.
Oh yeah, no. Yeah. There's a lot of nice lines, like when they bring up Mike Tyson and he goes into a high and falsetto.
Defense is impregnable.
Yeah. And this is when he says it too. Cage props Johnny up on the turnbuckle, tucks his head in, super kick right to the face, and then into an electric chair facebuster.
I hate everything. Everywhere.
Except for that. I was going to say, like, the fact that if you say you hate that fucking spot, you're crazy.
Psych, it was dog shit. Oh,
damn. Johnny goes for a moonlight drive, and that's countered into the Bluetooth Destroyer, a.k.a. the F5. And a lot of great spots, like I said. You get a missed end of the world to a discus lariat by Cage. He hits the Weapon X, and who comes down? Taya. She comes down, distracts the ref and Cage. Mundo hits Cage with a pipe and gets the win. So we get the debut of Taya, which means nothing to you because you haven't even been watching the show. But what did you think when you first seen Taya?
She's all right. She seemed okay.
She's all right.
She looks like she's in good shape.
Yeah. A lot of colors. She's very colorful.
Yeah. She didn't look out of place. I've seen some female wrestling competitors, and they don't really have any mass. Like, there's, like...
Like Carmella.
Yeah, she's just kind of thin.
Yeah.
She's not really athletically built. Yeah. This Taya girl looks like she could compete in a wrestling contest.
She could hurt you if you wanted to.
Yeah.
It's not like it's Kelly coming at you, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. Or Lita. You know, well, Lita was a different case, but she was definitely that skinny...
Yeah.
But like she could move and she could go around and she made it believable.
Yeah, this girl looks like an athlete.
Yeah, she does. And then we get, in my opinion, the line of the night. What are you going to do, he?
Huh?
Yeah, it's just like...
It's Canadian.
Yeah, Taya really...
She is Canadian, right?
She really shows off her Canadian accent there with the he.
Yeah, she wants a double-double.
Yeah,
sitting on a Chesterfield.
Yeah.
Maple syrup.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, she definitely does.
Sweat in Mexico because it's too damn hot.
Oh, too goddamn hot. So we basically, we go backstage after Johnny Mundo and Taya had celebrated a little bit. Cuerno comes into Katrina's office. Same guy. From
Yeah. He won the thing.
Says he's sick of being the hunted. He's used to being the hunter. He's giving in his Gift of the Gods title for a match against Mil Muertes next week. He's sick of holding it. Katrina declines. She said that we had a deal. You can't go back on that deal. Plus, I've already made a match for you next week, and you're defending that title against Phoenix in a ladder match. So it's like, oh, you've decided to go against me and Mil? Well, let's see if you can keep that title in a match against Phoenix. Because Phoenix and him had a match earlier, and Phoenix won.
Yeah.
And it wasn't for the title. Right? So it's kind of basically getting Phoenix a match back, being the good. I think it's just basically Katrina still wants Phoenix's dick a little bit. And she's giving me a little bone. She's like, okay, well, this puppy obviously is biting back. Let me see if Phoenix will wetten me up a little bit more. Because Mil's got a broken arm. He doesn't care about me now. All he cares about is sitting up on the throne.
Who broke Mil Muertes'
Pentagon.
Arm? Okay. Yeah. He's just breaking arms all day.
Oh, yeah.
Every day.
Whoever's arm he can break, he breaks.
He's like Ronda Rousey.
The only person's arm he couldn't break was Katrina's and Puma's.
Yeah.
Puma got out of it. So that's about it. You know what I mean? And that's essentially that show. That's Lucha Underground Episode 5. So next week, there's a match between Johnny Mundo. No, there's not. There's not a match between Johnny Mundo. Next week, there's a match between King Cuerno and Phoenix in a ladder match and a Prince Puma Pentagon match.
Yep.
What else, you know, we'll see when we get there. But that was this episode. It's time for the first annual Federation Mystery Box. It is not a box in which you stick your dick in. It is not a box in which you can get the clap. It is a box in which sweet things come out of.
Sweet things come out of. Have you ever thought of a wrestle crate, but for free?
Yeah. And all you got to do is tweet hashtag SmackDown6 to @TheFederation.
Now, what is that? SmackDown6 with the number or the letter?
That is... Either or. You know what? I don't care. SmackDown 6, spelled S-I-X. SmackDown number 6, I don't care. Hashtag whatever. Actually, no. I think you can't. I don't think you can have numbers in a hashtag.
Okay, well, let's do SmackDown 6 with the S-I-X.
Yes. So SmackDown 6. Actually, you know what? If you do it either or, I don't do shit. But you got a week to do that. So by the time episode 71 comes out, we will pick a winner and we'll be announced. And you will get sent, free of charge, the first ever Federation Mystery Box.
And I promise, this is a mystery
box. You don't have a fucking clue what's coming.
No idea.
Bye. Go back. Again, future presentation, blah, 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 stuff. Now, Tell, you said that you wanted to speak about Fastlane.
Yeah, lad. I'm really disappointed that we didn't get a chance to... do a review on Fastlane, Tyler, because it was just...
God awful.
My favorite.
Fuck you. Your favorite, my ass.
It was just the best. You have this heated contest. I can't do it.
What was actually really good, and I'll take the point to talk about this now, the next night on Raw, it opened up with a great segment. And that segment was Shane McMahon returning.
Yeah.
Right? And they were giving out the award to the Vincent J. McMahon. I believe that's his name.
Vincent Kennedy McMahon?
No, that's Vince McMahon's middle name.
Who's the other Vincent?
Maybe it is Vincent Kennedy McMahon. His father. His father's name.
Oh, Vince McMahon's dad?
Yeah, I think it's Vincent J. McMahon.
Yeah.
Basically giving out an award in his memory.
Yeah.
He's been dead for decades now, but...
Like Walt Disney.
Yeah. He gives the award to Stephanie McMahon.
Okay.
And she's giving her speech, and then all of a sudden you get, here comes the money, 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 and the crowd goes ballistic.
Isn't it way higher than that?
Oh, yeah, without a doubt.
Here comes the money!
Money, 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 money. But yeah, so Shane McMahon comes out in his Air Jordans.
Nice.
And suit and comes down and tells Vince that he hasn't lost his place in line for helping you out years ago with something bad that really happened. Basically, you're given like these little clues. Shane wants to run Raw. Vince makes him fight The Undertaker in a Hell in a Cell match. I thought the whole thing was amazing, the way they did it. It was just very refreshing from what you were used to.
Yeah.
It made a 30-minute opening segment feel very short.
Yeah.
Whereas usually they do 20, 25-minute opening segments with Steph and Triple H, and they're god-awful boring.
Well, they've been the same segment now.
Yeah.
For 3 years.
15 years.
Yeah. Daniel Bryan was still allowed to wrestle.
No, Stone Cold was your champ when they started doing this.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, the Vince Stone Cold angle is when this all started. They haven't veered away from it since.
Man, I'm so glad Daniel Bryan can't wrestle anymore.
You're just looking for heat in every which possible direction, aren't you?
Shaved his beard. Perfect.
He did shave his beard. But, you know, he went on record saying that the beard was not what he wanted.
Yeah.
But he was just trying to grow his hair, and the beard distracted from the awkward hair growth. Is what he, is the whole point of it, right?
Yeah.
But, no, I really thought Raw had a great hour. And then they just drove off of a cliff and went right back down again. But it definitely adds a lot to WrestleMania. But yeah, I don't know. Raw is really hard to watch right now.
I like this. Not this Raw, this Lucha Underground.
Yeah, it's so much easier.
You ever play Tekken?
Yes.
You know how Tekken's got like a karate dude?
Yeah,
the guy with angel wings.
They got a cheetah.
Guy with a puma head.
Yeah.
Just for no, they got like a panda bear.
Yeah.
But in that game, you're willing to suspend disbelief long enough that you don't care that there's a panda guy or a Eddie Gordo or a guy doing Taekwondo or a Mexican with nunchucks who's a half dragon. That's what this really reminds me of.
Yeah,
and
no, I agree.
I dug it. This was pretty cool.
It's very fun. It's new. It's refreshing.
Yeah.
It's very easy to watch. It's 45 minutes that you don't need back.
There's no filler.
Exactly. Exactly. There's something amazing in an hour of wrestling.
Yeah.
And the fact that people vote NXT to be better than Lucha Underground boggles my mind.
Yeah, I don't see that.
Because NXT is still a developmental territory.
Yeah.
You've got those garbage matches every week. NXT has
hashtag won. Elias Sampson.
Yeah, exactly. Hype Bros, you know, Blake Murphy. All these guys are garbage.
Yeah.
Eva Marie, Nia Jax. I fucking hate them all. But,
role reversal.
I know, right? I know. Oh, I can garner heat if I need it. One thing NXT has are solid takeover shows.
Yeah.
Like, who else is putting on a Sami Zayn Nakamura match?
Are that what they're doing?
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, NXT Dallas night for WrestleMania.
Yeah. Sami Zayn Nakamura? Was that announced at the last one?
No, it's not announced yet on TV, but, like, the tapings have happened.
Oh, man.
Yeah, so that's pretty cool.
I just felt a tightening in my pantaloons.
Yeah, no, it's pretty. And that same show is going to have Samoa
Joe. Nakamura better win.
Samoa Joe and Balor are going to be in that show as well. Yeah. Bayley and Asuka.
That'd be cool.
Yeah.
So I want Japan to win this World War II and a half.
I think they will because Bayley's got to go up to the main roster. Yeah. I feel after WrestleMania.
Let's have Asuka beat Bayley. Nakamura take the title.
Japan. There's no title.
Have Japan, or what's his name, Nakamura beat Zayn and then beat Balor for the title, and then you've got, like, a Japanese pairing.
Yeah. And the talk is, too, now that Nakamura's not going to the main roster.
Yeah, I heard that.
He's sticking to NXT, so. Yeah, I don't. In one way you look at it, they can't fuck. They're not going to fuck him up if they leave him in NXT.
Yeah.
On the second hand, though, it's like. It's Nakamura.
Yeah.
Bring him up to the main roster.
But, I mean, what matches can Nakamura have in NXT that would be really watchable?
In NXT?
In NXT.
Finn Balor.
Finn Balor.
Samoa Joe. I'm blanking. Apollo Crews.
Yeah.
That
would be at least watchable. I think that Lone Wolf guy.
I bet you Nakamura can get a great match out of Baron Corbin.
I bet he could.
You know what I mean? Yeah. Nakamura, I think, you can put a broomstick in with Kenny Omega, and that's been proven.
Yeah, I saw
that. Right? So.
But now, if you think about Nakamura on the main roster,
yeah,
who would you put Nakamura on the main roster to get like a real solid matchup?
AJ Styles, Chris Jericho, Kofi Kingston.
Kofi Kingston?
Oh, dude, they can have a great match.
Yeah, but why?
Dolph Ziggler.
Why is Kofi Kingston going to fight somebody like Nakamura?
Doesn't matter. We're talking about match quality. That's all you said. This match could put on a great match. Yeah. That's all you said.
Heels gotta lose sometimes.
Yeah. Brock Lesnar.
Okay, that'd be pretty tight. Brock Lesnar, Nakamura.
They've already had a match.
The Beast from the East.
They've already had that match.
Man, that'd sell pretty good.
It would.
Who won?
Brock. This was in 2004.
Yeah. Do you think Nakamura will have his like trademark yell that everybody's gonna do?
Oh yeah. Oh, yeah. The little videos that they've done of Nakamura already is still the same Nakamura.
They're already up?
Yeah, there's a 2.5 minute intro video to Nakamura.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll check it out after we're done.
Yeah.
It's gonna be nice to have Nakamura in the WWE.
Yeah.
You're not gonna get the same Nakamura as you're used to. You know, he's not gonna be fucking blowing heads off with his knees and shit.
He's not gonna blow AJ Styles' head off like he did with Kingdom 10.
No, he's not. So but you don't need that.
No.
Nakamura doesn't need to do that to get over, and he won't have to do that to get over. Vince McMahon won't let him do that to get over. But do you have any other pressing news that you want to speak about?
No, except that I'm going to say one more time, Rob LeFun, when you're ready, let's do it.
Okay, I will tweet at him. Maybe I'll tweet at him right now.
Let's see what he says.
Well, you might not get back in time, you know, because it is Twitter.
I don't have a Twitter.
You don't, because you're unapproachable.
Yeah. I'm like that pretty girl at the school dance. Just don't come talk to me.
At Robert T. LeFun. Actually, I don't think that's what it is. I can't remember. No, it's just Robert LeFun. Sorry, Rob. Sorry. Tell has just challenged you.
And I'll take Robin anything. Backgammon, a relay race, Magic the Gathering, a science fair, pro wrestling, jujitsu, Tetris. I don't give a shit. I could beat Rob. Best 2 out of 3 in anything. Except maybe for like being American or have a real punky haircut or playing in a fruity rock band. Hashtag the Wild Young Hearts.
Yes.
Hashtag Neverwhere, Nevermore. That was his high school band name.
Oh, was it?
Yeah.
I never ever knew that. So the tweet reads, and I repeat, at Robert LeFun, Tell has just challenged you to a contest, whether it be pro wrestling or backgammon. So we'll see. We'll see now. Let's see if we can get Mr. Robert T. LeFun to fly to Canada. Because Tell's a teacher, right? He can't just up and leave. He's molding young fucking minds here.
They're going to hate everything too one day.
And he's going to be so proud.
It's my empire. This is my design.
This is his Roman Empire. The Butler Empire. Held by Mr. Till. But that is this episode of Mucha Lucha. I just want to clear up some business here before we go. Make sure you sign up for the Federation Mystery Box. Your days are numbered in signing up for the Federation Mystery Box, people. You've got till Wednesday of this week, which would be February so-and-so. Maybe March. Maybe it's March 3rd. Today is March 3rd.
Yeah, today is the 28th.
Yes, Wednesday is March 3rd. You've got till March 3rd to tweet the Federation. You have to follow us, too. If you don't follow us, then fuck you. You got to tweet the Federation, hashtag SmackDown6, and you'll get a chance to win the Federation Mystery Box. You don't want to miss out. It's all a mystery. You'll love it. At least, I love it. And then follow us on Twitter, at the Federation. You can go on Facebook, the Federation Podcast. You find the podcast on mofudge.com, iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, and so on. Make sure to go to fom.us and pick up your shout-out by either Kurt Angle, Jake the Snake Roberts, or Honky Tonk Man, no matter who. If you've got a lady and she loves herself some Jake Roberts, okay? Just imagine you got a lady and she loves herself some Jake Roberts. Pay Jake Roberts to tweet her on her birthday that Damien the Snake is coming for you, baby, tonight. She would be all over that. And when you do that, I want you to type in the code FUD Podcast. Two words, F-U-D Podcast. And that'll get us a little bit of kickback from your purchase. So make sure you do that. Raking in the cash, baby, raking in the cash. And if you love what we do, if you love the podcast, you can go on over to our Patreon page and you can donate there. Hosting can be a bitch sometimes. It costs money. This podcast is free for you to listen to. It ain't free for me, bitch. So help me recoup some of them costs. let me buy myself a t-shirt or something, or Tim's coffee like I'm drinking right now.
But he had the microwave.
You didn't buy this one because nobody's fucking donated yet. I bought this coffee myself. Fuck. But yeah.
Tyler.
Say something in Spanish.
Hola, me llamo Señor Tell. ¿Cómo estás? Queso is Spanish for cheese. Oh, I can tell you a quick teaching story. I got kids that come at me and they're like, Mr. Butler, queso. And then I put my finger up and I'm like, queso is Spanish for cheese. And every time they look at me, they're just confused.
That's great. Okay, Tell. Little known fact. This show is named Mucho Lucha because I love burritos and I love mucho burrito, so it's Mucho Lucha. What's your favorite burrito you've ever eaten in your life? I know you're landlocked in Alberta. Burritos aren't a thing, and I usually have foreign people talking to me on this show who like live in California and shit, and they got lots of burritos to their disposal. What's your favorite burrito?
All right. This has a story.
Okay. That's more than grateful.
I was in Vegas.
I really hope nobody tuned out of this when I started doing the plugs. Fuck you if you tuned out. This
Whatever.
Is your loss.
This is part two. I was in Vegas a couple of years ago for a trip with some friends of mine, and we were walking out. We weren't on this. We were off the strip at like 2:30 in the morning, and we saw this truck. We saw people gathered around it, and someone's like, "Man, I think they're selling food." And so we show up, and there's like these tons.
Never seen a food truck before?
Not one parked in the grass at like 2:30 in the morning.
Fair enough.
And so there's these like four, and I don't mean like a food truck. I mean like a pickup truck.
Really?
Yeah. And there's these.
Wait. Is this story going to the point where you bought burritos out of a pickup truck?
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. Continue.
So they had like, they had some burners. They had a couple.
Some burners, you mean like burner phones or Coleman burners?
Like Coleman burners.
Okay.
And so they had like, they had little signs.
So this wasn't a shady operation. Hey, they weren't burning the phones because they didn't want anybody to know where they were giving people E. coli and shit, eh?
Well, you know, I didn't ask too many questions, Holmes.
No, obviously you didn't. Holmes. Essay.
And so we showed up. And I mean, this was probably some poor judgment on our part.
Yes.
We were like in our early 20s in Vegas. We'd gone to the casino a bit. We were in suits.
Oh, God, yeah.
And so we showed up.
They seen you a mile away.
And so we
we're
showed up.
We're going to get these cocksuckers with these fucking tainted fucking burritos.
And so we showed up and we ordered some food and it was real cheap. I had like a torta.
What's a torta?
A torta is like a burrito sandwich.
Okay, I would have figured it was like a turtle.
No. Might be turtle in it. I don't know.
Fuck it, you bought it out of the back of a truck.
It could have been like that scene in Cannibal Holocaust.
Yeah, it could have been the fucking the Green Inferno.
Yeah, oh, it's garbage. Did you watch that?
I watched it. You fucking idiot.
Yeah, it was garbage.
It was.
I had three. Okay, well, I don't want
to
talk about
it. I'm going to describe you the description of garbage after you've done this story, okay?
And so we ate this Mexican food out of the back of this pickup truck that was delicious. It was the best food I'd ever eaten. Old El Paso didn't have shit on this legit Mexican food. Oh, man, it was delicious.
There's a nice place in Red Deer. I can't remember the name.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Do you remember Taco Del Mar here?
Oh, dude, I fucking wish we still had Taco Del Mar.
I think it was like a crack joint. I think they had like some.
It could have been. Yeah. It could have been.
And that's why they were shut down.
It didn't last no time.
And it was good. It was always busy.
I love Taco Del Mar. I love tacos in general.
Have you been to that Burrito Pizza Express place?
No.
Up by Soto, that Japanese food place?
Yeah. No. Is it good?
I don't know, but it's like Pizza Express burritos.
Yeah, that doesn't sell me on your burrito, though. It really doesn't. I'd rather go to Mucho Burrito.
But it's a new burrito.
It is a new burrito.
I almost got into a fist fight in Mucho Burrito.
How?
Do we get time for the story?
Dude, it's a podcast.
All right, so I'm in Mucho Burrito, going to get something.
Yeah.
And there's a guy in front of me. 6'2", maybe like 7% body fat.
Oh, you sized him up, eh? You really sized him up.
He's a big dude. And if you were in front of him, if you were beside him, Tyler, you'd be staring at his ass the whole time because he was thick with steroids. And you were like, where are those needle marks?
Where you put the needles to, sir?
And he's having like a really bad day. Like he's about to Chris Benoit this whole place.
Oh, shit, eh?
And
you
so
smother somebody with a fucking.
He's on the right of me. I order. There's another guy who looks pretty frail, orders to the left of me. And so I order something. This guy's already going through. He turns to me and this other guy and he's like, fucking meat eaters. And I was like, what? He's like, yeah, meat eaters. Don't you know how they raise those animals? Like, he really, really cared about him.
What the fuck?
And this,
he cares about how you raise these animals, and he's pumped himself full of more hormones.
And so there's this really frail guy beside me. I think he worked at, like, Best Buy.
Okay, yeah.
And he's like, hey, man, how about you lay off my food? This guy's like 5'8", maybe like, I don't know, 180 pounds. Like, yeah. Playing Fallout for way too long of his whole life.
Yeah.
And this dude turns to him and, like, eyeballs him. And it's like, huh? You want to get smart with me, tough guy? Yeah, you want to take this outside? Huh? Huh? Is that what you're going to do now? And Buddy's like, nope, I messed up today.
I'm about to get Chris Benoit. Shit. And so now I know how Nancy felt.
The poor lady behind the counter is like, sir, I need you to calm down. And he's like, you better not burn my fucking burrito.
What? Wait, so this is a true story?
This actually happened.
Man. See, I would have been there and somebody would have been like, fucking meat eaters. Yeah, I'm fat too. What are you on? Like, fuck, Jesus, leave me alone.
It was ridiculous.
Obviously, I've made some fucking poor decisions with my dietary health here. Just lay it off. I know. You don't need to point it out.
I haven't said anything. Diet, you look good.
Fuck off.
This is more do you love, homie?
Yeah, I was going to give you the definition of garbage.
Let's hear it.
Okay. So last night, I went and watched the movie The Witch. I've heard great things about it.
Man, the scariest movie people have ever seen.
And that I don't get, because there is not one jump sequence in this movie. Not one.
Yeah.
There's not one moment where I felt tense. It could be part ways where I didn't understand a goddamn word anybody in the cast said, because they're in this quasi-old-time English lingo.
Well, it's New Hampshire, isn't it?
Something like that. And it's literally, I can only sum it up by the experience I had in the theater itself. It's the second weekend. It's already in the small theater.
Yeah.
It's I heard more laughs than gasps throughout the movie. Yeah, I didn't hear none of those. It was more of a... It was more of a... Right? Like, just little things that were maybe supposed to come off creepy came off as funny. And at the end of the movie, I can probably say a half a dozen people said, what the fuck is this? It was really bad. I was one of them. I let out an astounding, I've beat off to better midget porn than this. That was my life.
Man, that's really disappointing. I'm going to go see it tomorrow.
Are you really?
I'm going to go see it tomorrow.
I pity you. It's an hour and 40 minutes of nothing.
I will let you know what I think.
Joel said the same thing. He was like, I don't believe you. I've heard nothing but good things from everybody else. And I was like, yeah. Well, I don't care.
Well, you know what, Tyler? We should podcast about The Witch.
No, Joel asked me to, too, and I flat out said no.
What's Joel doing? Hey, Joel, you hit me up. We'll podcast about The Witch. Fuck Tyler.
Okay, fair enough. Make it a rare.
For those
that, fuck you.
I just did my Conor McGregor impression, in which I made it rain and then I flipped Tyler off three times.
And then his vagina broke just as he bruised his foot.
Yeah.
But that would single the end of the Flutteration podcast this week, everybody. I've went through my plugs again. You've heard them. No need of hearing them again.
Thanks for inviting me in, Tyler. I had a lot of fun doing this.
I was hoping you'd say bye in Spanish.
What is it?
I don't know.
Oh, no, I know it. Shit. Da-da-da-da-da. Not hola.
No, that's
not
hello.
Au revoir. Hang on. The internet knows.
Au revoir, that's bye in French, isn't
it? Bye in Spanish. Ciao?
Really?
It's Italian. Ciao. Adios.
Adios.
Adios, amigos.
Adios, amigos. Mucho lucha. Number.
Numero uno.
No, it's five. Four.
Uno. What are they? What's that?
Uno, dos, tres, cuatro.
Cincos.
No, it's cuatro.
Cuatro is four.
Yeah, we're four.
I thought that was five.
The episode was five of Underground.
You know what?
Mucho lucha is four, though.
You got to keep them separated. Offspring. Play the Offspring song after that.
No, I can't. What? Copyright, bro.
Well, then don't.
I got sponsors now, bitch.
Well, then don't sue Tyler the Offspring.
Bye.